It's a great pleasure for me to introduce Professor Alessandro Vespignani. He did his bachelor degree and his PhD in the University of Rome, La Sapienza. Then he did a postdoc at Yale and Leiden. And in those early times, Alex worked with people like Luciano Pietronero, Jean Stanley, and Benoit Mandelbrot. Then he became a PI and worked in Trieste and Paris Sud. And finally, in 2004, he was recruited to the US and started a very prolific center. This is the Center for Complex Network Research in Indiana University. And since a few years ago, we are lucky to have him across the river in Northeastern University as a distinguished professor in physics, computer science, and health sciences. To name a few key recognitions, Alex is an elected fellow of the American Physical Society and also of the Academia European. And I can also tell you things that are not so obvious on the internet, like Alex is a great cook. And more important than that, his scientific stature and personality has truly inspired many researchers, and we all work together in the Complex System Society. It brought people last fall around the world to Lucca, Italy, and next fall, we are all going to Arizona. The deadline is May 7th. So it's a good moment to tell you that. And finally, if you have to have a flavor of why Alex inspired us so much, I would say quick search, physical review letter, Pastor Satorras, Vespignani, epidemic spreading in scale networks, and you will see how cool is that. Let's then welcome Alex Vespignani.
Thank you very much, Lydia and Marta. Marta, thanks for the invitation. That was very kind of you. And she has mentioned that I am, my education is a physicist. Then I've been working in a math department. I transitioned to computer science. Now I am also in health sciences, and I will talk mostly about infectious diseases. I've never been affiliated to an engineering department, and so I'm truly honored to be invited here. At the same time, I'm a little intimidated. In Rome, what we were saying always in physics was, don't mess with engineers. So, please, I will try to give a talk that is very, interdisciplinary, and I will not dive into detailed structure of the equations and modeling, et cetera, but obviously I'm very open to discussion. I would like to, if you have follow-up, whatever, I would be very, very happy to get in touch with you. And let me thanks a few people. I will talk today about things related also to the Ebola epidemics and epidemic in the last few months. And I have really to thank some collaborators about that, the Center for Inference and Dynamics of Infectious Diseases, DITRA, MIDAS, that allow me to do that work. But however, I will show you a more general framework about what we do in terms of forecasting infectious diseases in the age of big data. And this is a work that we have done along the years with probably more than 40 collaborators. And really, I have to thank all of them, because without them, I would not be standing here talking about this work. And this is also a collaboration among various institutions across the world, not just in the United States, but also France, Italy, the Netherlands, and other places. Well, let me start from here. So, from time to time, I think that we do research, and our way of doing research is because we are, as humans, we are control freaks. So what we like is really to control things. And what is the best form of control, if not prediction? The fact that you can know in advance what will happen tomorrow. And this is something that we have started to learn when thousands of years ago when we started to control fires and so on and so forth. And obviously we have been very spoiled in natural sciences about that, because now you touch, you know, screen and you get, you know, the total eclipse of the moon for the next years with almost infinite precision. You can touch again your computer and get your weather forecast for tomorrow. And then you all know that we engineer airplanes in the computer before even assembling one piece. So we have control, we do prediction. And if we think about weather forecast, for instance, let's think about that. Every year this is an exercise predicting hurricane patterns that save thousands of lives. Although we could, in many cases, we criticize weather forecast, but you know, this is actually what we do every year. And obviously there are many forms of prediction and forecast. We can talk about terminology. I don't want to get into all these fine details. In some cases, we don't even talk about real forecast. We talk about scenario analysis, what we could say projections. And but you know, all that is what allow us to, in many cases, to do great things. And the problem is that, however, there are many, many areas in our actually more and more complex world in which we don't have control at all. We think about conflicts, we think about the next pandemic, we think about management of resources during emergencies. Actually, we don't even control traffic jams. You know, and this is something in a world that we know is more and more interconnected, where more and more we know that even little perturbation can ripple through the system and create major havoc. So why is all that? Well, is all that because basically what we have in those problems is ourselves in the loop. So the social component is crucial, and when you have the social component, obviously, you know, a lot of question arises since centuries ago. So, well, the social atom, the person, is very different from the physical atom. We have infinite dimensions in a cognitive and psychological space, etc., etc. So we are not predictable, and we could not predict what we do. And in addition, even if you imagine to have predictions, how you do experiment, how you extract those laws, you know, how you do control experiment on many social atoms. That was the big question. So that actually have been entertaining social scientists, you know, Jacob Moreno, 100 years ago, was prospecting, they were proposing, you know, Lundberg, social physics, although I don't like too much this term. But, you know, they as scientists, they were thinking about the social atom, the social molecules, the family, the household, the workplace, and then the social aggregate and how we can go from one place to another. Well, this has always been a kind of ambitious paradigm, and in the last years, however, we get into that because of, you know, mostly two major revolutions. One is what I call complex networks and system science, is the fact that we have learned in the past 50 years and more that, you know, we kill the myth of the ant queen. So we know that in many cases, you know, we can understand complex systems, and not because there is leadership, because there is our psychology, our dimension, but just because things emerges because of our interactions. And so in many cases, we can, in a sense, use that paradigm. And the other thing is that finally, we have the data to bring, you know, those kind of models, those kind of vision about social system into an experimental field, so in a data-driven area. And I will show you a few examples, you know, that is fueled by big data. Big data, it's something that, you know, it's impressive. Big data is, I think, is one of those words of slogan that is, there is a lot of hype about big data. But big data is not a matter of big data. Still, in the socioeconomic area, we produce, you know, every year more socioeconomic data than in the entire previous history of humankind. However, that amount of data is not huge. If you think, you know, to the Large Hadron Collider, you know, to those experiments, they produce much more data in a sense. So big data is not just the sheer size of data. It could be also small data in a sense, but these are data that were not accessible 10 years ago, 5 years ago. So this is the major revolution. And those data comes because of technology, because of innovation. And let me give you a few examples. For instance, now we can use a lot of those kind of little sensors, for instance, RFID tag. There are the experiment of Sandy Pentland at MIT with the social badge. There are many, many more and more pervasive technologies that allow us to measure face-to-face interaction, you know, at the level of single people. You know, like here, in which you see the interaction in a school, you see each class, you see how kids really have face-to-face interaction. They play together, there is the teacher. At a certain point, you will see that there is recess time and everybody's connected with everybody for a short time. And this is very accurate, you know, this is a time scale of 30 seconds or less, you know, and you can monitor those things in an incredible, accurate way. And that was impossible to think about those kind of experiments that now we can do those experiments for thousands of people at once. So these little devices now are, I would say, inexpensive. They record an amount of information that is impressive. And this is just one side. Then we can move to the what they call the mesoscale. You know, we can look at the movement of people in our daily activities. And all that is traced as, you know, Marta has been one of the pioneers in this area by working on mobile phone records. And, you know, we have many sources now that we can integrate. You know, we have GPS in every places, in our car, in our mobile phone, in our devices. And, you know, these are all information that comes, you know, for free from just our daily activities. And here a few examples, for instance, of things in which I would say the mapping of mobility was crucial in understanding a few features of diseases. This is a cholera outbreak. This was interesting for the situation in West Africa. And this instead at the level of a single city, what you can do in terms of mobility. And then we have obviously the global planetary scale. We can harvest all the data about our traveling, getting on a plane and 6 hours after land in another continent. And this is, for instance, is traces of people traveling from London to other places in the world. That was an experiment to look at how a disease could spread from London during the London Olympic Games. So you have all those sections of data, and I'm just mentioning, you know, I would say probably the tip of the iceberg. We could continue for hours to talk about the different sources of data and the proxy about human activities that we can get from those data. And the issue is what we do with this data. Those data obviously are, you know, delineate a complex world. So they define a complex world. And in this complex world, we have a large number of heterogeneous individuals. Those social atoms are still very different one from each other. Multiple time and length scale. So just looking at human networks, contact networks, proximity networks, we can go from a few seconds of interaction to, you know, to days, or the fact that you travel to one place and stay on a plane for 6 hours and then in another city for several days and so on and so forth. And we have to include all those time scales. There are all issues that you know very well: nonlinearity, threshold effects, cooperation effects. And if you want to have a look at the systems, in most of the cases, you need a systemic approach. You really need that the system as a whole. And you know, you will never understand, you know, by looking at one single school what happens when you look at the spreading of a disease or a contagion process on the United States scale. But at the same time, you know, you need to bring the fine grain level of the school to get a better understanding of what's going on. And I will try to address some of those questions. Well, what we do with those data? With those data, we would like to do forecasts. We would like to predict things. And well, there are different forecast philosophies, I would say. It's you know, I've been working in all of them, and I don't want to downplay one approach or another, but they are different. So the first one is for sure what I call, you know, you take a time signal and you try to get the next couple of points. This is what we do in many cases with simple linear regression algorithm, multiple linear regression, SF1 regression. So you have a time series and you try to get the next 2 points of that time series. Well, this is very successful. Actually, you know, weather forecast started that way in a sense. The simplest evidence is that, you know, that there will be winter and summer. You look at the time series and then you know what, that there will be summer sooner or later, no? But you know, this is obviously, we got very, very refined in doing those things. And in the last years, there have been a lot of people advocating for the fact that big data could fuel those approaches and make it completely different. And one of the classic example is what is called is Google Flu Trend. Probably you have heard of it. So you want to evaluate the seasonal influenza in the United States, and instead of looking at the data that comes from the Center for Disease Control, you first look at all the searches on Google with a certain number of keywords related to flu. And obviously you can say, well, that's a proxy for the people that has some problem with flu, and if I have the time series of that searches, I can do forecast. Why? Because I have the time series. First of all, the data are in real time, while the CDC data takes a few weeks to be crunched and collected, comes from doctors, and so on and so forth. So you have, as a first step, as what we call situational awareness. And then second, obviously, by using linear regression model, models of very, very complex, we can create a model that actually is learning is from the past and then can project, you know, in a few weeks in advance. The issue with those things is that we have to be very careful. You know, it's there is some major problem in this approach. This is very, very useful. It's, you know, Google Flu Trend as any time series analysis. But there is one problem. It's completely agnostic to what is the process you are looking at. That could be stock market, could be any other thing. So it doesn't make any difference. It doesn't include the fact that you are talking about disease except the keywords. And if you do this kind of statistical analysis, you are completely forgetting about the mechanistic process underlying the phenomenon. Well, what is the risk? The risk when you integrate this big data, this novel stream of data, is that you forget that, for instance, at a certain point, Google changes something in the way they do, they offer the interface to the users. At certain point, Google introduced the fact that if you are typing a search, it fills in for you. And that obviously creates huge biases. Or perhaps the fact that you start to include in the platform news and media. And then what happens is that at a certain point, you know, the signal perhaps goes completely by itself in a way that has nothing to do with the real signal. So what you have is that you have to continuously correct your system to take into account what's happening at the level of the way you collect the data. We are not talking about data coming from an experiment. We are not talking about a natural science experiment. We are talking about interaction of users with the platform, and they are constantly changing. And so, you know, we need to take this into account. And with those technologies, with those approaches, obviously, it's a little bit more slippery the way we approach the problem, because they are agnostic to what you are looking into the data. And the other thing is that also you realize soon something that you get basically a very good prediction with a simple two-legged non-linear regression without using all the search data, but just doing, you know, some kind of learning from the historic signal. So, you know, also how much you want to improve it's something that is under discussion. And then, you know, you also realize that there are things like that. For instance, that you can create a very good correlation if you look at, as a keyword, zombies instead of flu. And that, you know, it's a game because people tend to play with words in a way that is not totally, controllable. And you know, these are big issues. And so what happens is that what we are doing with those approaches, in my opinion, and that is my point of view, is that we are not actually doing forecast, but we are doing what we call nowcast. So we are trying really to get the time series and then get the next couple of points. There are many tricks we can do. We could be good. We need to keep in mind the biases and do a solid statistical analysis, understand the system. We can do that, but this is still not prediction. What is the difference from this? Is that to project the hurricane, you need the physics, you need the meteorology, you have the laws that govern the evolution of the system. And this is what we want to introduce in the system, in the forecast, okay? And to go there, what you have to do is to imagine, for instance, if we go to diseases, that you really understand how disease progress. And if you want to have the evolution and the dynamic of the system, you need to go into these kind of approaches that are called micro-individual level. So you start really to simulate the social atom. You start to simulate with different techniques that ranges from what we call meta-population approaches, that means that you look at urban areas and how they are connected, to real detailed agent-based model that look at each single individual. You know, you want to You know that the disease propagates because we are in contact. You simulate those social atoms and you try to understand what is the dynamics of the disease because you look at the basic microscopic mechanism that leads to the disease spreading. Well, those approaches have a lot of challenges. They are data-hungry models. There is a lack of information. You know, whatever you do, you will always have information that you are not able to retrieve on the system. You know, whatever model you generate is always just an approximation. And when you enter the social area, there is a big issue. Some parameters, some things you would like to know on the system will always be unknown. And I give you one example, but I will discuss more later. For instance, if I want to evaluate what will be the impact of a vaccination, I need to assume that people will get vaccinated. But that, unfortunately, is not something where I can do a forecast. That depends on many things that imply what is the compliance of the population, what is the awareness of risk, the risk perception, and things that are very difficult to measure. So this is not to say that it's easy to do that, but we can start now doing that. And if we do that, we always, and this is again is why network at the end. When we do those kind of very detailed mechanistic model, at the end, what we do is to work with networks. What we do is these kind of approaches, to give you in a nutshell how it works. You recreate what we call a synthetic population of an entire city, of an entire country, at the level of the single household. So you map each single household. The guys who are in each single household, their son, the age of the son and the daughter, et cetera, et cetera. And then you map where they go to work, where they go to school, et cetera, et cetera. From that, you construct a huge bipartite network that is the number of each individuals and where those individuals go, the locations, and how much time they spent in that location and who else is in that location. Then you collapse that in a single network that tells you the interaction among individuals. And this is a multi-network in the sense that there are different kind of interactions in the household. As you can imagine, for instance, the probability of transmission of a disease is much larger than on the workplace and is much lower than in a kindergarten and so on and so forth. And you have all those mapped for hundreds of millions of people. Well, if you think about that 10 years ago, you say, well, I like a lot that, but this is obviously out of reach. You cannot do that. and how long it will take this guy to go to the work. I need to consider that, and so on and so forth. Well, now we are in the position to construct those kind of models, and it's a major revolution. Well, when you introduce the network thinking in these problems, we need also to understand that we change really the way we look at the system and what we can understand of the system. This is a simple example where you see the network thinking at work. This is the Black Death spreading in Europe in the 14th century. The Black Death was coming from East, was approaching Europe by ship, and then it has spread through Europe almost like a wave. Obviously, there are geographical boundaries and many things you have to consider. But if you look at records of the epidemics, and actually, you have to keep in mind, this is really an epidemic that wiped out almost 50% of the European continent. So you can understand that there are records of that in all cities in Europe. There is still, a story of what happened. If you measure the velocity of this wave, you get a result that is known since really 50 years. You find in Murray's book in biology. You find that the velocity of propagation is about 4 miles per day. Well, you immediately know what is going on. The mobility of people at that time was just to go from one village to the nearby village for trading. There were no long-range movement almost. The only long-range movement, and some are mapped in this different acceleration of the wave, was because of wars, where you have a big mass of people, that was able to go about 10 to 15 kilometers per day, et cetera, et cetera. So you see that this is really like a wave the disease moves like a wave in this slow progression, from village to village. Well, then in 2002, you look at the SARS. The SARS is an epidemic, was a respiratory illness. Perhaps most of you can remember that this epidemic. It started in China. There is not too much information on the early time in China, but then went to Hong Kong, the first index case. From Hong Kong, it went to Canada and United States. Then back, we were spreading to other places in the Far East. Then to Europe, from Europe, within Europe. This is obviously has nothing to do and doesn't resemble at all a diffusion equation. Okay, that is very far from it. And you immediately understand that now you're working on a different substrate. Our mobility now is a point like origin destination matrix that you know better than me, that is, that is driving the spreading of the disease. And so you have that in a short time, all these things is completely different and seems totally erratic. And the issue is that actually is not, and we can understand that, but is driven by the mobility of people. So we need to include those elements in the process. What we started to do about 10 years ago, and it was a big computational platform to study the emergence of infectious diseases. It contains different layers of data, those data that finally we can get. For instance, accurate map of the population, probably most of you knows the LandScan project and similar projects. Mobility, human mobility at the level, obviously you, for the long range mobility, you can download the entire International Aviation Association database. If you look at commuting, you can use different sources and proxy. We have collected that for a number of countries in the world, all over the continents. And then obviously we integrate those also with gravity laws, with the radiation laws, and we have a portfolio of models that we can use for mobility. On top of this synthetic world, we can study the spreading of a disease. If we have a few index cases, we can look at how people travel across the world and how the disease will spread. Obviously, this model requires that for each disease, we know the specific disease dynamic and the parameter of the disease. There is no model that fits all diseases, and diseases are very, very different, I will tell you, as I will show you in a short while. Well, to be a little bit more technical, this is what we have. So basically, it's a layer that is the population, various mobility layers, that means how people move from each of those census areas to other census areas. Within the census area, you can use other network models. You can use more detailed network models at the level of urban areas or other scales that you might think. Obviously, the more you push on the lower resolution or the global scale, and the more the problem becomes computationally heavy, and then you need high performance computing, and as we'll see, the problem is how you calibrate such a model. What do you do? Here is one example of what you do in terms of diseases. So for instance, you imagine this is the what we call the natural history of the disease. So how the disease, one individual that is susceptible gets in contact with an infectious individual, go through a latent period, and then there are different kind of symptomatic stages you can go through, and then you recover. In some other cases, you die. And obviously, this compartmental structure becomes more and more complicated the more you want to be realistic, even about the single disease in a single person. And there is a number of parameters that tells you what is the transmission, what is the probability that you will go from one state to the other. Those parameters have to come from the field. This is what, you know, people working on patients will tell you after a certain time. For most, many diseases, we have record of that, but you have to keep in mind that in many cases, each virus, even if it's the same disease, is not the same virus. And so we'll have that those parameters will change even if you're looking always at flu. Flu has a range of values for those parameters, and each strain has a different value. Well, a little bit more of what is under the hood. At the end, what is under the hood is a huge stochastic algorithm with, large number of stochastic discrete equations that represent the evolution of the disease at the level of single individual. You represent the mobility of people across the different census areas, and this census area can have different resolution from large urban areas to even the single household. And you know, by simulating the movement of people, and among the people there are the carriers of the disease, you simulate the spread of the disease. Well, what you do is that you create an interface like that one that allows you to exploit, for instance, this is an epidemic starting probably in the Far East somewhere, and then you can look at all places in the world. We look at maps. We look at, because this is familiar to us, the usual incidents, etc. Actually, you have to keep in mind that the way mathematically we do that is a network. Is a network of places, of subpopulations. And the algorithm works on that, on something that is a complete abstract structure of a graph that could change depending on what kind of mobility you plug in, what kind of resolution you're working with, et cetera, et cetera. So it's really, for us, it's simple to then to rationalize and understand what's happening in a map, but you don't need that. You are in a different space. Because, you know, at this point in our modern world, the distance is something that is somehow irrelevant. What is more important is the coupling of flows of people from one place to another. Well, at this point you could tell me, okay, you did something very, very interesting, but this is like SimCity. That looks like a video game. Can you do that for real with this modeling or not? Well, yes, actually, that was what we have done in the last years, so to try to validate the model. The problem is, luckily, you know, to validate the model, you need a real-time event, and we don't want to have too many real-time events. We got in a couple of them, a little more than that, and the first one was the H1N1 pandemic in 2009. This is a new flu strain originated in Mexico, in a region that is called Puebla, that is a heavily farmed area for pigs. The virus jumped from pigs to humans and started to have sustained human-to-human transmission. It was flu. For flu, we are a little lucky. There are a set of parameters that we know do not change too much from strain to strain. And this is what we call plausible parametrization. Then you do sensitivity analysis. You can change things. But more or less, you are confident that you can rely on those numbers. Then there are structural data, transportation, mobility, demographic, et cetera, et cetera. You can work with those as an output. The problem is a few key parameters, like the transmissibility of the virus. So if I'm sick and I'm talking to Lydia for half an hour, what is the probability that she will be sick at the end? That depends on many, many things, complex things of the virus, and it changes. The other thing is what is the what we call the generation time. So how long is the disease history, in a sense? So how many days you will be in an incubation stage, how many days you will be infectious, and that changes also strain by strain. The other things, another important component is the seasonality, how much that virus is pushed by seasonality. We know that flu is worst during winter, but how much is worst? And how much is for a new strain? Well, those parameters you don't know, and there is no way that you will know in a reasonable time if you want to do real-time epidemics. So what you do is to resort to numerical techniques, again based on networks. Because what you can do is to look during the first 1 month of the epidemic to the area of the world which gets infected by transporting an index case, in this case from Mexico to London, to Paris, to other places. Then what you do is that you partition the space of parameters that you are trying to estimate. And for each of point in this space, obviously this is what is called latent square hypercube sampling, you create runs, many runs of the model. So basically you generate for each parameter set thousands of simulations, and you get distribution for the time of arrival in the various countries of the first index case from Mexico. You compare with the data that you have, and you can construct a likelihood analysis. And so what you have at the end in the parameter space is an area of the parameter space that tells you what are the values of parameters that are most likely representing the history of the epidemic till that moment. When you have these parameters range, you can start to do projection and do real-time forecast. You, at that point, focus on that area of the parameters that well describe the epidemic till that point, and then you start to project, you know, for the next 2 or 3 months. Well, this is what we did at the time, and this is the prediction that we got for the countries in the northern hemisphere. And this is our confidence interval. You know, this is the 95% confidence interval. This is the usual whiskey bar. So, you know, whiskers. And you see that there is something that if you notice, it's a little strange. This is November for the northern hemisphere. Well, you know that actually you should have the epidemic peak not in November, but actually in January, February, in some cases can be even later, because of the winter push that actually is included in the model. So the fact that you get a peak in November is something that is just explained by the initial conditions, the transmissibility of the disease, the fact that you see the disease because of mobility during the summer. During the summer it gets lingering on, and then it can start earlier, and so on and so forth. But these results, I will always remember, some of my colleagues, not Marta probably, but some of my colleagues told me, you don't tell anybody about that because you are likely to be wrong, and this is really going to be bad for the field. And then we say, no, guys, if it's wrong, it's wrong, but you know, we need to do that. So we communicated with agencies, et cetera. And then we also published this late August, early September. After 3 years, we can look at from data from the field. You can collect for all those countries when it was the peak. And then this is the result. So you can get, with those models, you get very accurate results for the epidemic peak by the week, almost by the week. And so in some places, you can be a little off. You know, for instance, France and Switzerland, it took us some time to understand why. They have a school break, you know, school starts in September. They have a 2-week school break in October. that we couldn't imagine to happen, because why they are going on vacation after 3 weeks of school? But you know, that this is like that in France, and obviously this pushed back the epidemic. So if you include those, you start to include in those fissures, you need really the microscopic things. But this is not to tell you how much we are successful. There are other models and, you know, other groups were working. So this is to tell you that those kind of approaches works. It's not just us. You know, this philosophy works, can tell you things with a couple of months in advance. And that's important. It's important to assess the vaccinations, to alert hospitals, et cetera, so give you an idea, an intelligence on where, what to do with the disease. At the end, I always say the people that fight the disease are the medical doctors in the hospitals, and always my hat to them. You know, this is the things. So what those methodologies can allow you to get the intelligence. It's like in wars, you know, and knowing where the enemy will strike, when, and how much, it makes a difference in some cases. Well, obviously, you can use those approaches also in the case of seasonal influenza, to do seasonal influenza forecast and get perhaps a little bit better prediction more than 2 weeks in advance, understanding what are the basic parameters of influenza. Where with seasonal influenza, however, is much more complicated. It seems paradoxical, you know, because you say, well, seasonal influenza is every year, you should know everything. Yeah, the problem is that you don't know the initial condition. When you have a pandemic, just at the very start, you know the initial point of start of the disease. It could be a region in Mexico, it could be a region in the Far East or in the US, wherever. But you know that the disease is just there, it's a pandemic, it's a novel strain. Seasonal influenza is always with us. And you know, you don't know who is sick and what are the initial conditions. And so that's the difficulties. And so just to tell you something, we are now trying to do this kind of forecast by introducing social media data as an initial condition, but not in the sense of Google flu trend, but really just to calculate the relative weight across the country of number of infectious people in October, November, at the early stage of the epidemic, by measuring, for instance, how many people talks about flu on Twitter, on Facebook, et cetera, et cetera. And I don't need the exact number of people. I need to know if there is more in Texas than in Boston or in Massachusetts, and so on and so forth. From there, you can start running the model and do a complicated calibration analysis that allows you to do prediction. And so you start to merge things with the social world. Well, epidemic network modeling has a lot of things that are really still open. So this is still brute force computation. You do simulations, but you want to know more about you want to understand, you want also to have the analytics of that. And there are a lot of problems that goes from the landscape, is the effect of the details that you introduce in the disease, the time scale, the the network. The network is not static. It changes. Our context changes, and the disease spreading too, and how the two things interplay together. We generally are very good when we decouple the network from the disease. We consider a static network, or we consider a network that is so quick that everybody is in contact with everybody. So these are the two limits we generally handle. All intermediate situations are much more complicated. So these are all still open question. I can tell you that with those models, you can get a little bit of understanding. For instance, length scale and synchronization effects. You can decide to look at the diffusion of a disease. This was a kind of this was pandemic influenza in the United States coming from the Far East. And you can look at what you get if you use a model in which you basically don't have commuting, but you just have long-range transportation, airplanes, or a model in which you go at a very detailed level and you include the commuting flow of people. Well, you see that the two cures are not so different in a sense. Well, the The one with the commuting is more as, you know, as one peak, but, you know, the peak timing is not very different in the two approaches. You have issues like here in New England. You see, in one case, you have two peaks when you don't use the commuting, while you have one peak when you include one, when you include the commuting. Well, why is that? You can understand immediately. You know, these are the major cities in New England. And, you know, Boston and Providence. And then you have other places like Provincetown, Portsmouth, etc. If you don't include the commuting, what you get is that you get an epidemic in Boston and Providence much earlier than in the other city, because then you wait for somebody from Boston or Providence to fly to Provincetown or to Portsmouth to have a long-range, you know, fly there. And we don't go there by plane generally. Somebody we use it, but generally we go by car. There is more that kind of diffusion. And if you include that diffusion, the peaks becomes much more synchronized. And so you tend to synchronize the epidemic. So this is important to tell you what is the effect at different scales of the introduction of those details in the overall shape. You might say, you know, I don't care too much about all this synchronization. I want to have more or less the peaks at the global level for 220 countries. Well, I drop, you know, all these details about commuting. Instead, if you are looking at New England, well, you need to get the commuting. And if you're looking within Boston, you need to go to the household level and the school calendar of the city of Boston. Otherwise, you will not get reliable results. Other things is the nonlinear, what I call the nonlinear thinking that we have in those systems. I'm telling you that everything is because of mobility, and you would say, well, then to stop an epidemic, I do travel restrictions. That's the best way to limit an epidemic. You can try to do simulations, and for instance, you can do a 50% travel restriction across the world, up to 90% travel restriction across the world. So you progressively freeze the world. And you see that the arrival time of this pandemic, this is actually is the modeling of the H1N1 pandemic, is delayed by a couple of weeks. So basically you do a huge perturbation to the system and you get a very tiny gain in terms of arrival. And that's because you have a nonlinear mechanism that relates the arrival time with the travel restriction. It's logarithmic. So basically, you know, you have to go to 100, almost 99% to see large deviation. One order of magnitude will give you one factor, you know, and in this equation. And so this tells you that, you know, there are very non-intuitive effects. Another non-intuitive effect is the fact that how I do really contain the epidemic by travel restriction. Well, you can imagine what happens. Let's imagine you have a city here. This is a city, and you have an infection here, an epidemic here. Well, let's imagine that nobody will travel ever. You know, the city is totally isolated. Well, the epidemic will never spread globally. Nobody's traveling. Nobody will. All the other cities are safe. Then imagine instead that in that city, every individual in that city, at every time step, at every day, get on a random airplane to one place in the world. Well, in this case, what you get is that it's like if that city is virtually connected to all other cities in the world in a complete homogeneous mixing. Well, in that case, the epidemic that was, how to say, exponentially growing in this city will get also increasing in the other cities. So you get two different regimes, and there is obviously a critical point in between that separates the global spreading from the non-global spreading. And if you can calculate this value, you can have back on the envelope calculations or very detailed calculations, and what comes out from those calculations is that in the current level, with the current level of mobility in the world, you need to contain an epidemic, you really need a 99% travel reduction. Otherwise, the epidemic will tend to spread. So it's just a delay. So there are many things that you can start factoring in that comes also from a knowledge of phase transitions, tipping points, et cetera, in those systems. Let me use the last 4 or 5 minutes to talk about Ebola, because this is something that happened recently. Ebola is a disease that you have probably read about it in the newspapers in the last few months. It goes from an animal reservoir to humans. Is lethal, and what you find yourself in the situation that okay, there is an epidemic in a place that is remote and far, like West Africa, and you want to understand how it will. What is the pandemic potential or something like that? Well, the early stage modeling games were two. One, to understand, okay, there could be an internationalization of this epidemic or not. And the second is, what can we understand about the situation on the field? What do we have to build Ebola treatment units? What will happen to the course of the epidemic in the next few weeks, et cetera, et cetera? Well, there are a lot of problems. In this case, you lack a lot of data. And the only things that you can do is summarize here, start where you are, use what you have, and do what you can. That seems a very nice slogan. Actually, is a sentence from a tennis player, Arthur Ashe, that was saying, you know, when you are in a bad situation, you just do what you can. And this is what we did. Likely enough for Ebola, there were some data that could be used initially, estimates for the disease dynamic, data on international mobility that we know very well, and a lot of data on those countries. And this is, again, the big data revolution. Now, even in Sierra Leone, Guinea, and places like Liberia, etc., we can recreate the synthetic population at the level of single household. We know how many inpatients are in their hospitals. We know the exact GPS location of all clinics and hospitals. And that's thanks to OpenStreetMaps. You know, things like that. Unthinkable a few years ago. Well, the disease dynamic in this case is pretty complicated. I don't want to go into the details of that. But there are three major settings for the spreading of the disease. One is the community. Another one is the hospital. And another one is the funeral, where you have to, the body of a dead person for Ebola is one of the most infectious things you can imagine. And you do things similar to what we did for influenza, but on this time we didn't have the exportation of cases, but actually the calibration was on the number of infections that we were observing that the WHO was reporting from those countries. And those are data which are biased, incomplete, so there are many, many, many things to take into account. Well, what we did initially was to provide probabilities of importation of cases across countries in the world. We were mapping 200 countries. This was the top 15 countries at risk. You see United States is here, but the two different colors are different models that were depending on the level of screening at airports. And you can start to project what is the probability of importing cases and tell agencies, what is the risk of observing cases across the world. And the other thing is that you really create maps, for instance, at the level of urban areas with a risk associated to each city, what could happen. And this is a situation map in November for United States. You see that there was a big risk in New York, and indeed in New York there was one case, and so on and so forth. Well, the first index case in the United States, the real case was in Texas initially. The epidemic, however, changes its course. You know, its course changes in time from the initial growth that was projected exponentially, then containment measures enters the game, and you enter a stage of marginal containment. At that point, the epidemic is in a kind of is borderline, and then you get into a phase that is we call containment, where the epidemic should really die out. It's not clear really where we are at the moment, because it could be, depending on the countries, there are different how to say, level of containment. But obviously you see that you get different scenarios at that point. And this is where you have to start working also with scenarios. And this is what our projection of the number of observed cases worldwide changing from the exponential initial exponential growth to the various containment scenarios. And you see that the situation is completely different. So in February, we would have seen hundreds of cases, while actually, since it was a situation in between those two, the probability of observing even a single case outside of the West Africa was of a few percent. So actually was a kind of reassuring picture for what was happening. If you want to, however, to get more understanding, you really need to go to that level of modeling that I was mentioning to you. So you really need to go to the household level. You need to model single hospital, how people seek healthcare, and so on and so forth. And you can do that and get even maps at the geographical level within those countries. You can measure things that clinically are almost impossible to measure initially, like how many people on average are infected in each family. You know, it's very difficult to get those data. It's called secondary attack rate in the family, things like that the model can tell you and can help to get an understanding. You can get the spatial progression. So for instance, with the model, you can look at the observed week of the first case in different provinces of the country and then compare with the predicted week of the first case. And let me say, this is more or less a good statistical agreement, although if we would have the possibility to analyze data like mobile phone data from the regions in real time, that would be much better. Unfortunately, it was impossible to get those data, although the government tried to get those data, it was impossible. So this is a good, reasonable agreement for the level of zoom in that we have in those countries. And you get to the level of looking at intervention. For instance, if you build an Ebola treatment unit, how much cases you can avert in the country. If you do safe burials of people, you have safe burials team, how many cases you will avert, and so on and so forth, at the very accurate level of provinces. So this, you start to get real intelligence that is getting more and more detailed. This is still work in progress in the sense that now we are working on Guinea, that is a region that is still suffering about 20 to 30 cases per week. That is a huge number, although now it seems small with respect to what was happening months ago. Well, let me say that there is still one big scientific challenge, and this is something that has been, how to say, it's I swept under the carpet in a sense, and. You know, people here has been working on that, Juanes and Marta and Nicolas. So it's how what happens when you start to introduce the adaptation of society to the information that you give to the people. So if you are aware of a highly lethal disease, your behavior will change, your way of going from one place to another will change, and you have to include all that in the projections, in the modeling you do. But that is a kind of close feedback, because if you change the data, your projections, your forecast will change, and if you give those forecasts to the people, you know, they could change again their perception and risk perception, and so it's a kind of feedback loop that is continuously working. And here is, we have really still big problems. There are a lot of models that we are working on, but all those models need data that are very difficult to get. And here again is where big data are helping us a lot, because now there are ways to collect data in real time also about risk perceptions, about mobility of people. We can look at cold data records in real time, and so on and so forth. And here is really my last slide. Okay, I'm really over time. I'm sorry. I think so. It's, we need to go from at this point from the geographical space and the physical space of diseases to the social space. And this is what we what we want to do, extending the metaphor of contagion not just to biology but also to other areas. And let me close here. This is, for instance, is the protest in Spain on May the 4th, and this is how on Twitter that protest, you can monitor that protest and really look at the emergence of that protest. And this is, I think, is the future of the field, where really we will extend the contagion metaphor to social systems to get prediction, not just of disease, but also of other systems. I'm sorry, I'm a little too long. I've been a little bit too long. Thank you very much. Please.
So from your talk, I have the impression that this is something that you know how to do and it's a matter of doing it. Is that correct? Or what sort of methodological work that you need?
Well, there is a lot of work that has still to be done, in the sense that there are work that is computational. As you can imagine, all that work that you have seen, it's still painful. You need high-performance computing, and so how to improve all that. The level of details, we are not yet satisfied. You need, in many cases, what is asked from you is what is the incidence of the disease for age brackets, how to optimize vaccination campaign, and this is still things that we are working on. And then there is the last part. You know, for Ebola as well as for other diseases, in a sense, at the end, there has been never, you know, for instance, a major pandemic able to disrupt society. But if you want really to keep into account the risk perception and what is the resilience of the system, we really have to yet to figure it out how to do. So how to that feedback loop, how to close it? It's still a matter of research, both in terms of data acquisition, but as well as modeling, understanding how it works. We really need the help of social scientists, how to really mimic those processes, what are the fundamental processes. And then if we enter the area of social systems and how to understand social phenomena, this is still completely open. I would say that there is no way that we can talk yet of forecast. Yeah.
How did you combine
the two exactly? Well, the SIR model is a model in which, the SIR is a model for the disease. And then you can decide that each individual, so what you do in the original model is that each individual has a tag, is a susceptible, infectious, or recovered. The SIR is just a disease model. You can complicate that as much as you want. You add more and more compartments. The SIR model cannot be used for realistic modeling, actually. You know, it can just be for illustration or for conceptual purposes. What you do is that each individual is in that stage of the disease. And then if I'm in contact, I'm infectious, and I'm in contact with somebody for a certain time, I attempt to transmit the disease. And that is in the computer is simulated by a stochastic process in which each individual attempts those kind of transmission. When you are sick, you tend to go from the incubation stage to the infectious stage. Again, it's a transition, it's a spontaneous transition that you have. And there is where there is another big area of research, how we simulate that process. There are many, many approximations. You cannot do what is the time scale you use? If it's one day, it's totally different. If it's 10 minutes, 8 hours, and the way you simulate those processes can be with effective force of infection, so you feel a kind of general mean field, or you can go on a network perspective in which you really monitor each interactions, and there are many, many different possible theoretical schemes you can use.
I think what you're trying to do is you're trying to predict demand behavior, or try to model demand behavior, which is very difficult or almost impossible. I'll take, for example, in case of the spread of diseases, people travel from one place to another. Assuming that people's travel habits are predictive and show some sort of constant pattern,
obviously one may be able to predict the next outbreak of certain disease in an area with some sort of predictability or some sort of error variance. I mean, from what you've done, do you have an example or an actual sample of how your research into big data has been able to give you guys, provide some sort of prediction?
So you're, if I ask correctly the question is, you say, well, you were talking about diseases perhaps is possible because mobility is predictable, but if you think about other social phenomena, that's different. We are much more unpredictable. Well, you know, this is what I was telling at the very beginning. It's true that we are unpredictable, but you know, we are, first of all, I think we are much less unpredictable than what we think for 90% of the things. And this is also one of the contributions by Marta. You know, it's, you can find that, you know, we are predictable in our patterns. And our patterns, not just in terms of the recurrent mobility, but really in the places, in what you will do statistically. Always, you have always to to think that we are talking about statistical predictability, not obviously, you know, I will never be able to tell if a single individual will go here and there, but you know, just in probability. For diseases, it's a little easier, but then as I said, as soon as we move out in a situation of social disruption, this too could be difficult. However, we can gather real-time data about that, about the changes of behavior. And you look at the change of behavior at the aggregate level, and you know, generally for major events, we are quite predictable. So if, you know, there is a major epidemic, you know, I'm pretty, well, we have never been in that situation, but people try to evacuate cities, to flee. And, you know, this is predictable. And as soon as you will start to have data on that, you can create models that project on that, and so on and so forth. So for diseases, it's still, I think we can do that. On other social phenomena, is more difficult. But it's, again, it's a matter of finding the interaction and the correlation that builds in the system. And, you know, in many cases, what this is what complex phenomena and fast transition have taught us. You know, you have very complicated things that seems totally, you know, disordered, but, you know, from their interaction, it emerges a collective behavior that is predictable, in a sense. And this is my hope, and this is what I believe, that for many, many cases, you know, social collective phenomena are much more predictable than what we think.
And can we kind of extrapolate it to a place where, for example, it was mainly out of Africa and so on? Can we predict then how far east or maybe say a certain country like Australia or India would be affected, and who are susceptible to them? Can we have those predictions in place by this stochastic model?
Okay, that's a great question, and if I can summarize, is you say, okay, you did that for biology. Now, can you say when we will have the next pandemic, and if we will have the next pandemic, what could be the outcome, how more population could be more susceptible, etc.? So the first question, when it will be the next pandemic, no. No one has a crystal ball. People in that does phylogenetic biology, et cetera, can and are working to identify what are the mutations in a virus that are dangerous, that can bring the virus from an animal reservoir to humans, and so identify, you know, the hotspots and how to say the wanted enemies, in a sense. But it's difficult to say when that will happen. Nobody has that crystal ball at that place. When we have a few cases of that disease, we can start to work. What we can do for your second question is how to measure the impact across the world. That is to create what we call a kind of atlas of what could happen with diseases. So we can imagine to run those for a huge amount of models, a huge amount of parameters, and create charts of what could happen that, in a sense, are more or less ready when you have a certain emergency is to look at and say, well, more or less the pattern could be that one, and you can create risk maps and things like that. That too, however, is not easy because there is an infinite number of initial conditions, different numbers of parameters that you can consider. So you can try for specific diseases, pandemic flu. You can try, for instance, to say, well, what if we will have Ebola in Zaire the next time and things like that. But in general, to say what will happen with an emerging disease is very, very difficult, more in general. So that's the other things that with big data you can do. This is something that, for instance, John Brownstein's group at Harvard Medical School is doing, is to create early alert system. So by looking at social media, data, aggregated data, et cetera, you try to see before you have all the clinical full alert from the WHO, you are trying to create the conditions to detect anomalies and try to see, okay, here there is something that is not working. For instance, their group, this is called Health Map, was able to say that there was a problem in West Africa a couple of weeks before any official alert. And so, in a sense, this is becoming powerful technologies as well, because it will give you some more lead time. The lead time is what you want in those situations.
Okay. So, one quick question there.
You mentioned that you were using social media data to predict some spreading. So usually disease has got a certain distribution over age and also social media, but probably a very different distribution over age. How much do you take this into account?
Age. Age is a crucial aspect. Age in the disease, we have a way to tackle the problem. So it's what we call, what we define is contact matrices. Those networks with age can keep into account the fact that if you go to kindergarten, you are very likely to be in a hot spot because kids do crazy things that transmit diseases very efficiently. If you are, you know, a retired person that just go to Stop and Shop, once a week, it's much more unlikely that you will get the disease. You can embed this in the contact networks. In terms of the social media, this is one of the big questions. So how much? All the data that we get from this huge experiment big data that we get from social media are representative of the society that is out there. Is the Twitter demographic resembling the actual demographic or not? And here we are getting into another big area of research. Obviously, you can start to stratify things, create samples of it, but even that, it's not enough. It's not just a matter of age. Perhaps all the people on Twitter must have a level of geekiness that make them different from the average. I don't know. So you start to discuss all those things. And obviously, there are a lot of criticism about big data in that sense. And this is, I think, is where we have to be very careful. So big data doesn't have to be seen as the solution to our problems. It's an opportunity, but in some cases it could be misleading, in some cases have to be treated, and it doesn't mean that we have to relax our statistical analysis and tools and try to, extract those biases and see. On the other hand, it's still true that Facebook has basically, I think now, 60% of the US population is on Facebook, so this is something that is so massive that you start to get, it's difficult to say it's not representative in any sense, you know. At least, when you know that in social science you have those polls that are made on 1,000 people in most of the cases, and although you can select the population, et cetera, there are biases also there, et cetera, et cetera. So, but I think these are problems. This is where the research is at the moment.
Can I have a closing question?
Yeah.
The area of big data, obviously, here is using a lot of computational power, and the frontier computational enabled us to really simulate these things. But there's also some analytical tools and the governed networks, but it's very hard to do anything with a mobile network, for example. Any reformatting network, there's no analytical approaches to tackle the predictions. So my question would be, in some, what are the areas in theoretical areas, analytical areas, that would be in the next frontiers that would enable to really see through without only relying through the empirical data? What would you see that to be?
I can tell you the areas, although, you know, if I would know exactly, I would probably not tell you, because this is a number of papers and very relevant publication I won't share with you, but no, but, you know, well, the bottleneck, at the moment, there are two major bottlenecks. One is what, how we deal with time-varying networks. Networks is discrete mathematics. It's great to have those networks, you know, when you have a snapshot of it. Then when you have 100 snapshots of it, you start to have those slices. But let's imagine that you have, as we have now, data streams which are continuously in time. So at this point, you have those tensors in which one dimension is time. And there, you know, there are big challenges, technically and theoretically, what to do with that. And there is a lot of work that is done at the moment that I think is very promising, but it's still on how we extract structure from it. If you ask me what happens for dynamical processes on there we have really at the frontier. Then there is the issue of multiplex. That's another area that is very hot at the moment. So these networks are made by different kind of interactions. So I cannot use a network to describe my interaction on Twitter and the one in the real world and another one in the workplace. So you have those networks, one over the other, those layers, and they are connected in different ways. So you create those what is called multiplex of networks. And again, I would say that there is a lot of mathematical formalism that has been defined so far, but if we look at hard data and calibration and experimental evidence that we can use those, we are still lacking that. The other thing is a little bit more, I think it's one big problem that is more philosophical, but at the same time very important and mathematically a big problem. So in dynamical systems, we are now controlling the predictability of system. We know about chaos, we know about all those things that allow us to say, well, if I will tell you what will be the weather in 6 months from now, you will laugh at me. In those systems, we don't have that rigor. So what happens when you have, you know, those dynamically extended system on networks? What is our predictability window? What happens to those dynamical equations when you are on complex networks? What are the actually, there is little that we know. So it's my, can I do prediction for 3 months or 6 months? Obviously, for instance, in biology, on a disease timescale, you have days or weeks, and then you can project for 1 month or two. But more is legit or not? This is a big question.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.